up, ladies and gentlemen? Jesse Warden here. Today we're going to talk about dictionary attacks. What the heck is a dictionary attack?
Jester XL versus Bear. Round one. Fight.
Otacon, the dictionary.
You win.
Yeah! Programming, gaming, fitness, Jesse Warden.
No, not that kind of dictionary attack. In our last video, when we talked about brute force attacks, they start to fall down when the length of the password or string that made the hash increases, as well as the variety of characters it utilized. Normally, if you do a length of three, you know ahead of time, and you're not going to try combinations that are one character long, combinations that are two, or combinations that are four and above. You're just going to try all three-letter combinations. And when I say letters, I mean all lowercase. You're not going to try everything up here, right? Numbers, uppercase, lowercase, and basic symbols. If you don't do that, then cal takes about 9 milliseconds, and finding cal takes about 120. But once you do all and change it, let's say to 4, it takes about 127 milliseconds. Once you change it to 6, so you have, let's say, cal as your password here, and 6 characters long, and you're trying all combinations, even though you didn't use them, you still have to try them just in case. It takes a minute and a half. So you can see where brute force starts to fall down. So to solve this, you use something called a dictionary attack. Dictionary attack basically takes a list of words. So we're going to loop through a small list of words here. A dictionary consists of just a list of words, one per line. And these are words that people commonly use. So rather than saying AAA1, you're going to use passwords that people normally use. In my case, cow, today, chicken, etc. But you can also get this big one from Crack Station that has human only. And these are words that people would normally use, like their favorite teams, pets, video games, things like that, with symbols attached to them, and every combination thereof, including numbers and letters. And that one's really big. You can see that this one is 716 megs. So I could load theoretically the whole thing into RAM, and RAM is super fast. The reading it for the dictionary attack would be super, super fast rather than having to generate it like we did with the brute force attack. But this is small. Most of these, you can actually get ones that consist of the entire English language, some Greek gods, a lot of the European symbols, etc. And those are into the gigabytes, 56 gigs, for example. Loading that in RAM is not really feasible. And the way you do that kind of stuff in Node is you use streams, where it reads a piece of it at a time, gives you some, and waits, and handles all the buffering. So I haven't really talked about Node streams. I'll talk about it in a future video, but just know that it allows you to read really big text files. We do the same thing we did before. We create a hash of our password, which is cal. We get a password hash here, and we start timing it. So we're going to get a chunk of text, parse that out to a list of words, and say, all right, look, using filter, I want you to tell me only the hashes, once we get that word and hash it, if it matches the password hash. If it does, give me back that into an array. If that array isn't empty, that means it found a match. We found the actual original word that generated the password. So let's show you an example. We'll run it, and you can see it generates the hash just like before, and it gets this first chunk of words, a small array here. It loops through them, and the fifth one, it gets cow, and within 5 milliseconds, it basically found the hash and says we're good. So that's cool for small text. It's pretty quick, but normally when you get these are gigantic, so you have to use streams to do it. So we run it, it's going to start from the symbols, then go to the numbers and every combination. Now I've slowed it down by logging each one of the console here. So every 10,000 or 8,000 chunks of words that it gets, it loops through. It tries them all and sees if it works. If not, it calls the callback and continues on. Once it finds a match, it stops reading from the text file. So it's got to go through A, B, C, and D. So that's one of the problems of using a single processor, a single core, a single computer, instead of, you know, concurrently sharing the work via paralyzing your work. But once we get to the lowercase cow here, it's going to match. And so you can see that just to find the password of cow, it takes about, what, I think it's going to say 37 seconds. Yep, it's not much faster at all when this one took 127 to find 4 characters that we knew ahead of time with a variety of symbols than the brute force attack. But watch this. One of the strengths of dictionaries is that they don't care how long it is or what symbols are in it. So we're going to run the same test again. I'm not going to make you wait, but we're going to do it with 6 characters. There we go. It found cow in about 35 seconds. So you can see it's almost one-third of what the brute force attack was. So this shows you why dictionary attacks can compensate for the weaknesses of brute force. If you're concerned about brute force attacks, that's why people want longer passwords instead of shorter passwords, and they want to use a variety of characters to help defeat brute force and increase the amount of variations of words that the brute force attack has to generate to see if it found a match. Whereas in dictionary, it doesn't care about the length, it doesn't care about the symbols. It literally reads a list of words, a lot of which contain passwords from compromised databases that may actually be your password you use in a lot of different sites. So that, ladies and gentlemen, is how you do dictionary attacks. And while brute force attacks are susceptible to longer passwords with a variety of characters, you can see how dictionary attacks do not have those problems, merely by reading a large list of potential passwords to try.